This is a production of Cornell University.
So, I think it seems like potato week or weeks. 2 weeks ago, one of my colleagues from Potato Center, she was presenting, and today I have opportunity to talk to you. So, I am Awais Khan, working at Plant Pathology section in Geneva. I'm also, as Dan said, I'm a new faculty. I started my position in October. And maybe some of these slides you might have seen in my during my interview presentation. So the outline of my presentation is, first I will briefly speak, as Dan said, and I think he has done a good job. I will be talking about my career so far. And then I have divided my presentation into two parts. First part is my work on abiotic stress tolerance in potatoes and sweet potatoes in Lima, Peru. And then second part will be my research program, research and extension program at Plant Pathology to look at mechanisms of disease resistance in rosaceous fruits. So, as Dan said, I'm from Kashmir, Pakistani side of Kashmir. I did my bachelor degree in plant breeding and genetics, and there I worked on castor oil plant safflower. After I finishing my bachelor degree, I went to University of Göttingen in Germany, where I did my master degree working on safflower and oil seed crop. And then I worked for ETH Zurich to work on apples, and there I worked on a bacterial disease of apples called fire blight, and I will talk more about that work as well. I didn't stop my journey, and I went to University of York to work on a medicinal plant called Artemisia annua for my postdoc, and then later I came back to apples and rosaceous fruits at in University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, where I worked on fire blight and in apples, and also I did some comparative genomics in pear and other rosaceous fruits. And in 2012, I think it was also October, I joined International Potato Center as senior scientist to lead a global program on adaptation and abiotic stress tolerance in potatoes and sweet potatoes. And now, from October 2016, I am in beautiful Geneva. And actually these days, and this week, last week, it's very nice in there. So you can imagine, 2000 October, it was nice, beautiful fall colors, and all of a sudden it was, yeah. Okay, so International Potato Center. International Potato Center is part of CGIAR consortium, and many of you know about this consortium. This world's one of the biggest consortium, and there are 15 CGIAR centers globally. For example, some of you might know CIMET in Mexico working on wheat and maize, whereas IRI in Philippines working on rice, and several others. So this similar way, International Potato Center, the headquarters is in Lima, Peru. And like other centers, the headquarters is in Lima, Peru, but there are several country offices and regional offices. And these regional offices are not only in South America, but also in other developed countries. For example, in sub-Saharan Africa, we had big office in Kenya, Nairobi, from where the operations in different African countries were carried out, and also in Delhi, as well as in China, in Beijing. So as I said, it's the headquarters is in Lima, Peru. The potatoes, they originated in Andean mountains between in Lake Titicaca between Peru and Bolivia. And this country is very beautiful, very interesting. It has diverse environments from sea level, from the Pacific Sea, you can go up to 6,000 meters above sea level in the Andean mountains. and potatoes can be grown in along this whole elevation, and also, and when you think about sweet potatoes, you can go to the other side on Amazonian rainforest, and you will see a lot of sweet potatoes. So it's very interesting and interesting country in terms of agroecologies. But this slide is one of the key slide which I want to make a very important point, that headquarter of International Potato Center is in Peru, but you have seen that country offices are in developing countries in sub-Saharan Africa, are in Central Asia, are in South Asia. So potatoes, they are in gene bank in Lima. The breeding program is doing selections in Peru, but because of clonally propagated nature of these potatoes and sweet potatoes, it's not easy to move this material without cleaning and laborious multiplication and all those international regulations to outside. So it's very important to actually evaluate them and to see what traits they have and how these traits are relevant to the outside target countries. So that, therefore, it's very important to first understand the target countries where you want to send these clones or to have the impact from these potatoes, and also the level of stress. For example, I was working on abiotic stress. So if you have drought stress in Central Asia, then you have to understand what is the drought stress in Central Asia, when the drought happens during the potato physiological growth, and then based on that you select an environment for your experiment in Peru, so that when you send this material to your partners in developing countries, it's very relevant, or at least has some relevance, because sometimes you work with developing countries and partners, and they are not interested in research questions. They are interested in excellent clones, the clones which can be released as varieties. And if you have sent them some clones which you don't know much about them and you don't know about the performance, then they will not be happy with you, and this collaboration and future partnership will not work. So therefore, we were trying to first characterize in depth the target environment where we are going to do the experiment, where we are sending the clones, the target stress, and then based on that, we are trying to find the homologous environment in Peru to do the experiment. And we were doing the same thing, historical data on weather, on soil analysis, and all those features to find this homologous environments. So you can see here, this is southern Peru, which is very dry, desert-like environment, and also in highlands you can have the rains at certain points. So to evaluate in these all conditions, it was very important. Then we were trying to evaluate those traits in depth in those experimental sites, and evaluation of those clones depends on the drought stress you're working on. The abiotic stress you're working on. So for example, if I was working drought stress, we were also looking at NDVI reflectance, chlorophyll content, but also canopy cover. And for canopy cover, and also different tools which we were using, like thermographic images and so on, we were trying to make evaluations so simple. The tools should be so simple that if you're working with partners in different countries, they can also use them with little technical expertise and also operational expertise. And then, of course, at the harvest, we were digging out the root system and also looking at the yield of potatoes, and then correlating with these traits with the traits taken by different tools. At the same time, we were also interested to increase the throughput and decrease the subjectivity, and we were developing some methods using drones and putting some sensors in these drones like tetracam multispectral sensors, which we can take images in the drought experiment in three different treatments: well water, terminal drought, and also deficit irrigation. And these multispectral images were from red, green to infrared spectral, from 520 to 950 nanometers. And at the same time, we were also looking at metabolite profiles of these plants in these stress conditions. And here, for example, in a preliminary experiment, you can see that in a stress-sensitive, drought-sensitive clone and drought-tolerant clone, there are some compounds which show significant difference between these two clones. And for example, proline, which is well known, was showing significant difference. And we were thinking to use near infrared, some easy methods to quantify them, so that first, if we can find the metabolite with this more technical methods, how we can use them in less technical methods in the field in developing countries. So that was the idea. And of course, if you're working on potato and sweet potato and working on abiotic stress, if you don't look at roots, and if you don't look at tube storage organ development, I think that is a concern. So, but for the young people, I will say that, and I used to say, and I still believe, if you want to see another green revolution, working on roots and underground traits is the way to go forward, because above ground traits have been explored a lot. So it's not easy to look at the traits which are underground unless you do destructive sampling. So there's a lot of potential to be explored. So what we started to do, we started to do chevalomics, like Jonathan Lynch says. We were digging out the plants and then looking manual evaluations. And in preliminary experiment, we were able to establish that if you have root dry weight at 30 days in drought condition, you have tuber dry weight at 60 days highly correlated with it. So it means early root establishment could be good indicative for later tuber yield. So this gave us confidence, and we started to look more in if we can do storage organ phenotyping in aeroponic system for potatoes, or if we can do simple assay like where we can let sprouts of potatoes to make roots, where we can look at number of roots and also the elongation rate of the roots. So for example, there are three genotypes, 1, 2, 3, 6 days, 9 days, 14 days, and you can clearly see the difference in the number of roots and also the speed they are progressing. So these things could be, with the image analysis softwares, you can actually see these differences. So I think in these first few slides, what I was trying to highlight, that characterizing your target environment, your experimental environment is the key, and the trait you're working on is the fundamental. And then once you have these two things taken care of, then you can do genetics, which will be very relevant. For genetics, we had a mapping population, not tetraploid potatoes, but diploid potatoes, simple genetics, simpler. There we had a mapping population which was used to anchor genome sequence of potatoes, and we had a dense genetic map, and we used that mapping population to do QTL mapping for drought stress in greenhouse and also in field. And you can see that we identified several QTLs for different drought-related traits like NDVI and SPOD and so on. But what you see from this figure is that there are several traits which show specificity to specific environments. Either they, you see QTLs in greenhouse, but you don't see them in the field. And that's very obvious. And especially when you're working with quantitative traits with minor effects, this will be very obvious for your traits. But there are some traits which were also showing consistency between greenhouse and field. So I'm I also want to present you another project which I had, and this project also shows you the complexity of the work which could involve, and especially for clonal crops. So we had 370 clones from advanced breeding population. And this project was funded by GIZ, a German donor, and we sent this to six locations, and one partner in Germany was collaborating for some other technical aspects. And these 370 clones were in all these locations, in three provinces of China, Peru, and also Kenya and Ethiopia. To get these clones in those environments, it was one of the big hurdle, big challenge. And then the idea was, and we were actually, we collected weather data, soil data, and then the idea was that we train, and we actually trained these partners how to collect trade data for drought evaluation. And we were actually present in the sites when the data was being collected, so that we have reliable data, the data goes back to the database, and then we have also genotype these 370 clones and to do marker trait association analysis and also to look at the extent of G by E. So this project is ongoing, and there will be very exciting results coming out soon. So just, I think, two, three slides for sweet potato. My research program was working on both potatoes and sweet potatoes, and I got more funding for sweet potato. And as you can imagine from sweet potatoes' importance for food security, health, and nutrition, many donors were interested to fund this work. But to do abiotic stress research in sweet potato was at a different stage compared to potatoes. One thing is hexaply, other thing is there are not many research groups working on sweet potatoes. The genomic and genetic resources were not as advanced as you see for potatoes. So we got this funding from Gates Foundation, which is, this project is led by NCSU, North Carolina State University, to develop genomic tools which will later enable abiotic stress and biotic stress and nutrition quality research and breeding. And this project had seven partners, and from Boyce Thompson Institute, we have Lucas Mueller for database and also Sungjin Fei. And the objective is, I was the lead for SIP for four countries for this project. We were working on genome sequencing and developing different populations for different objectives. And at the same time, we were developing high throughput genotyping platform for hexaply sweet potatoes. Also developing database with Lucas Mueller's group, and also tools for hexaploid mapping like QTL mapping, genomic selection methods, and so on. And then this was proof of concept objective where we were actually doing phenotyping in multi-locational trials, like you have a NextGen Cassava project to do QTL mapping and genomic selection in this objective. And this, which is very close to my heart, was the training and capacity building for those partners in sub-Saharan Africa. So we were doing webinars, web-based courses, and also in-person training, short, and also for PhD students. So this project is making a lot of progress now, and now I'm working here on apples, but these results are coming through. For example, genome sequence of diploid relative of sweet potato is almost done, which is Sungjin Fei and Robin Buell from Michigan State University, transcriptome sequence, genome browser. We also have very nice genetic map algorithm developed, and which is able to construct the map at hexaploid level. So this paper is in now is in consideration for publication. And this slide maybe looks like closer to the end, but I think this is one of the first thing one has to think about when you are putting a multi-location, multi-year project with multiple partners. If you don't have good system to put your data in, there will be a lot of mess later. You will not be able to correlate anything. So I think Nowadays, we collect so many dimensions of our data, like transcriptome sequence, genome sequence. We have metabolome. We have phenotyping for so many traits. So setting up a database is key. And I was supervising database development and tool development for database for potato center. And this is example from sweet potato. So we were not only looking at the tools to collect the data, like smartphone apps and pocket PCs, but also the apps which can be used to scan the barcodes, and also then automatically you get an app in your smart device where you can enter the data. And then you plug it in with this central database that it goes back there, and then you can relate different dimensions of data and the environment data as well. So this is again another very important aspect when you are thinking of this kind of projects. So outreach and extension, my program at International Potato Center was heavily involved in training and capacity building and outreach. And I will say I can divide man into three main categories. One category was building the capacity for the partners who are part of your project, because if they don't have the capacity to do the experiment, you will not be able to successfully complete your project. So for example, in clonal crop, if you're sending 370 clones to Ethiopia, you have to see if they can multiply it, they can keep it, they can propagation and maintain the cleaning of the material or not. So that's one thing, and you have to help them. But also when you're doing the drought evaluation, you want to make sure that experimental design is coherent. Also how the trait evaluation is being done, so that you want to make G by E analysis. But at the same time, you want to give, or one wants to give, and we were doing this last year in February. We organized this workshop in Peru, where we had colleagues from James Sutton Institute giving training to our national institutions in Peru for genome editing. So I think building capacity of the partners or the people, the countries and institutions you're working in, is very important, that when new tools come in, they are able to uptake them. And then sharing that, you're well familiar with this, that you share your results with the community, with wider community who might not be part of your projects, but can give you excellent ideas for research, as well as you can build new collaborations through that. So we organized first sweet potato and jam genomics workshop at PAG that was started last year. So with that, I have so many collaborators that I cannot list, you can imagine, but some of them are here, and I would like to thank the team, the excellent team I was able to work with at International Potato Center, postdocs, research scientists, research assistants, field workers, and the people who were also waiting when we were harvesting that what could be left, they can take on their donkeys and everything. So it was quite dangerous sometimes. So with that, I will finish my sweet potato and potato part, and I will switch from palm the tear to palm the air. So I think you must have realized my back was hurting digging the potatoes and sweet potatoes. So now I want to stretch out. So from October 2016, in Plant Pathology, I'm setting up a research and extension program to look at mechanisms of disease resistance in rosaceous fruits. And so far, we think following four broad categories for this research and extension program. The first category, I think, we are putting together different activities, is understanding mechanisms of disease resistance and characterizing mechanisms of pathogenesis. We are also interested to look and develop high throughput plant resistance phenotyping, and then based on these, develop tools for accelerated and targeted development of varieties with improved disease resistance. So don't think that I want to do everything. But with time, it will also get more focused. And I will show you a few examples in the next few slides. How I'm doing with time. If I still have time? Yeah, I have. Okay, so the rose family. I'm not good to pronounce rosaceous fruit, so I will say rose family. And it's nice to say rose family. So rose family, I think most of you are familiar with this. Many fruits which are very close to your heart, apples, pear, peach, plum, name it. And rose, very important, they belong to this family. It's very it's very important from commercial point of view, and also nutrition and health. And because of its importance, commercial importance, genome sequence of several of them is available, and many genomic resources are available for many fruits in rose family. Globally, after China, U.S. is the second in apple production. And if you look in U.S., within U.S., after Michigan State, you have Washington State, you have New York State, and then Michigan State in apple production. And therefore, I'm thinking that our research and extension program will be focused on apples from rosaceous fruits. And from plant pathology point of view, these diseases, fire blight, apple scab, mildew, and bitter rot, they are top. They're important diseases for New York, but also globally. And we are going to focus on fire blight and apple scab for this research and extension program. So fire blight caused by bacteria called Erwinia mylovora. It can infect apples and pear, and it can infect blossoms, shoots, rootstocks, and even fruits. And fire blight, actually, it is easy to recognize from the symptoms. You will see the plant which is infected as burnt by fire, dark tissues. The first report of fire blight was also from New York, in Hudson Valley, in pear orchard. And since that was, I think, 1790s or late 1700s, and since then it has spread to almost all apple producing regions with few exceptions. And that we don't know what could be the reason for that, but for example in China we don't have reports, in Japan we don't have, we had at some point but then there is no more, and then in Australia. So yeah, it's another research question to look at. But yeah, most of apple producing regions have fire blight, and it can kill the whole orchard within weeks if you have aggressive strain present in your orchard. So there are control measures which have been proposed. For example, you can restrict the movement of material from infected parts to non-infected areas, and that has been used in Europe a lot. Cultural practices like pruning and eradication of infected shoots and trees, chemical use like antibiotics and copper, biological agents, and host resistance. And the host resistance is, I think, is one of the most sustainable and has greater impact on fire blight control. And that's also very close to my heart. So I will be, and the research program will be working on host resistance heavily. So there is natural resistance in apples against fire blight, and but most commercial sign and rootstock cultivars like Gala, Fuji, rootstocks like M9, M26, they're highly susceptible. So theoretically, you can use this natural resistance which is present in apples and breed it and have resistant apples. But in practical, it is not that easy because of long juvenile phase of apples and self-compatibility. And also fire blight, sometimes you see it and sometimes you don't see it, and it's very sporadic, depends on the weather you can still have the inoculum in the trees, but you will not see the symptoms. So therefore, marker-assisted selection, developing the markers linked with trait, and then use them in breeding program for selection of seedlings is one of the ways to improve resistance. And this slide, I think some of you have seen it from my interview presentation. I still didn't change it. It's the same. So I believe that not only for apples and rosaceae fruits, but in general for crops, I think this could be a way to go forward, that you look at resistance mechanisms in the host, and there are several ways to look at it. You can do QTL mapping, you can do transcriptome sequencing, you can do several ways. But at the same time, you have to look at pathogen. And pathogen, how you look, you can look at emergence of new strains, you can look at population dynamics, one can look at mechanisms, how the virulence is caused by these pathogens. But based on this information and this information, then you are in a good position to develop a resistance improved varieties. And that could be either marker-assisted selection if you have candidates, genomic selection, or you can do transgenics. You have option for that, assist genics. And then you can also create novel variations using genome editing in the candidate genes. So during my PhD, I did a QTL mapping study where we infected the parents and the progeny of a mapping population and took data after first, second, and third weeks of, after inoculation. And the data we took is the infected shoot and the total shoot. And then we calculated the percentage of the infection and used that data for QTL mapping. At the same time, we also constructed the genetic map. And here what you see, a QTL explaining 38% of phenotypic variation was identified on chromosome 7. And this QTL was not only statistical ghost, but was validated in a different genetic background. And when this QTL is present, you can see significantly less disease compared to when the QTL is absent. And was also pedigree of this QTL was traced back, and using the markers flanking the QTL was used in some other varieties, where you can see that if the QTL or the flanking markers are present, they're significantly less susceptible compared to, they have less disease compared to the ones which doesn't have the QTL. So because of this robustness of this QTL is heavily used in apple breeding programs. So until now, there are more than 30 QTLs which have been identified fire blight, and some of them have been validated, some of them have not been validated, some have major effects, some has minor effects, and some are from wild sources. So what we are we also have a lot of markers from 1536 in 2012 to 480K and GBS and dot sequencing and several other options of markers. So looking at those two resources, what I'm planning for this year is this experiment. And the third important component, if you want to work with apples, and if you're in Geneva, this could be the one of the best place to work with apples, beside those other resources I mentioned. So there is a National Apple Collection in Geneva, and also Scion breeding program, and also rootstock breeding program in Geneva. So I got very lucky to get this 9 populations from USDA collaborators, and also from Scion breeding and rootstock breeding program. We grafted this on one standard rootstock, and then now these plants are in the greenhouse, and the sprouts are almost getting showing they're getting big now. But we are also not sitting silent. We are preparing the killer, the bacteria, so we are ready to infect them once the shoots are big enough. But one thing which I want to highlight, which I learned also from the big projects from International Potato Center, is proper labeling. It's a very simple thing, but there could be mix-ups. There could be later you have so many dimensions of data. So we are using, we are labeling all our plants with barcodes, and these barcodes are readable using a tablet. And in this tablet, we have a field book app, which is from Jesse Poland, who was graduate from Cornell also. And here we can enter the data instantly. So we don't have to write this on a paper and then go back to the lab and do transfer this electronically again. So that's a simple thing, but I think it will be very helpful for us in future. Also, another thing, that one of this population which was highlighted here in red, Jay Norelli, one of our collaborators from USDA Kernersville, and also Herbert Winkel, they shared some phenotypic data on fire blight for three strains. And I have this data which was also in field and greenhouse. And we are looking at the QTL map. We are trying to do QTL mapping for this phenotypic data, the infection data. But these three strands, WAEA273 and this strain, if you quickly look at this heat map, you can see that this strand seems very aggressive. If you read this key, the dark is 100% infection compared to this strand and this strand for the same population. So we are expecting to have more than one QTL segregating in this population. There could be strand specific. So very soon we will have some more results to share. I think I'm getting close to finish the presentation. Here is another very exciting project we have started to do, because being in Geneva again, we have access to this big collection of apples. This collection which is held by USDA in Geneva, they have phenotypic data, which is visual observation from 1 to 5 scale for shoot blight, 1 being resistant and 5 being highly susceptible. And if you look here, this is the proportion of accessions in each species. These are species. All, every bar is a species. And these different colors are showing proportion of each resistant or susceptible class accessions. And if you look at these two highlighted ones, which is Malus domestica here and Malus suicida, the progenitor of apples. And just looking at colors, red being highly susceptible, you can see that Malus domestica, domesticated apples, and Malus suicida, the progenitor of apples, they have a higher proportion of accessions being susceptible compared to some of the wild accessions. So therefore, what we, and also I had done actually evaluation in my postdoc for a core collection which was overlapping some of the accessions here. And the data, although it's from field, this data confirms that resistant are resistant here and susceptible are susceptible here. So I, in a way, trust data a bit more because of both greenhouse and this field. So based on that, we done selection of 450 accessions to do to develop donor stock for novel strain specific in broad spectrum resistance for fire blight. So these are five major QTLs. So we will be looking for the alleles which are coupling with resistance in these 450 clones, but also we are hoping to identify new alleles and new sources of future QTL studies and functional studies. So this has been also grafted, and we are now waiting for the plants to get enough long enough shoots so then we can kill them or we can infect them. And this is also in collaboration with several colleagues in at USDA and Lance Carol Davison for the amplicon sequencing markers. We also started to look at potential to improve disease forecasting models. If we can include resistance, genetics of resistance in the forecasting model, can we improve that or not? So I think it was also a good learning exercise for me to look at New York State. So from we downloaded data from 51 stations for this weather-related parameters. And my postdoc, she did multiple co-inertia analysis. And you can see based on this this data, at this 51 station from 51 stations, there are six different distinct groups: Long Island, Hudson Valley, Champlain Valley, Finger Lakes, and also Lake Ontario and Erie. But what you see here is that, for example, this is Finger Lakes, and it also shows in this correlation or heat map some relation with other regions. So we are trying to get historical data for fire blight outbreaks to see that if this grouping based on temperature, weather parameters and geography relates with the outbreaks or not. And then we will be able to actually correlate this and get better picture. So this is one slide showing that we are also working with several other colleagues on different setting up several preliminary experiments to look at with Zhang Junfei and Gennaro Fazio, we are working on looking at fire blight resistance, which could be modulated by rootstock in science. And actually today, I got a good news, Matthew might be here or he's not. We got funding from approval from ARDP for this development of genome editing platform for apples. And this work will be done with in collaboration with Matthew Willman from Cornell Transformation Facility. Great. And then with Larry Smart and some other colleagues at Geneva in plant pathology and horticulture, we are also we submitted a proposal to develop high throughput phenotyping for fire blight in the field and and if we got funding, we will also start working on that. So with that, I would like to acknowledge two of my postdocs who are brilliant, excellent, and they are helping me to set up the lab and also set up these experiments. And also the collaborators, which are actually helping me to share their resources and also their knowledge on different aspects. So with that, I would like to thank you very much. You know, it's difficult to predict. Just you know, what I will say, from 2014 there was fire blight outbreak. In 2015, people were predicting that there will be fire blight outbreak because of the weather and previous year inoculum buildup, but there it was not. So I think it's not. There is sometimes uncertainty to say and to predict, but we are starting to tap into previous historical data and also weather patterns and see, okay, if we can refine and this off prediction things, we can improve that. But at this point, it's difficult for me to say how. But varieties mostly they are susceptible, so and inoculum is present. So.
Is sweet potato auto or allo hexaploid?
It's auto. It's difficult one.
So did you say you had diploid varieties in that, or?
There's a diploid relative of it.
Relative
of it. So still it's difficult to say that it's really the progenitor, but if you do the phylogeny, it is one of the closest one. Yeah. So I think that's why it's difficult for sequencing also, because of autopolyploidy. So wheat is easy, you know, three different genomes.
Are you working at all on the genomics of the bacterium for fire blight?
So at this point, no, but we have interest from also co-evolution point of view. You know, if the first report, I don't know, I have to still dig more into the literature in that, but the first report was in Hudson Valley. There are three native species from North America, and I think I don't have much time, but in the picture you saw, based on the field observations, those species, they show high proportion of resistant accessions. So I have some, you know, some interest to see it, to see that if there is any kind of that this first it was reported here, then maybe it was transported outside. So to do that, sampling from those three regions where the species are, and then looking at genomics of that. Yeah, that's the interest. But at this point, I'm using my startup money.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.